Hi, my name is Barnaby and I'm an amateur guitar maker living here in Tokyo. And I make instruments using only hand tools because, well, I live in a small apartment, the landlady is next door and I really can't make noise or a lot of mess. I get asked a lot about which tools I use, so I thought it would be convenient for me to make a video where I go through it and explain it. And so I've divided things into seven broad categories. Saws, planes, chisels, sharpening, drills, files and rasps, and other. And then at the end I'll talk a little bit about the minimum kind of tools you might need if you want to try making a hand tool guitar in your own home. Let's start out by going through some saws. And there are three basic types of saw you're really going to need if you're building an electric guitar. The first type of saw you're going to need is something for cutting out complex shapes, you know, bodies, around headstocks, that sort of thing. And when I started out, I used a coping saw. And a coping saw is great, you can cut curves and do all sorts of things. The problem is, if you want to cut out a thick body blank with a coping saw, it takes a long time and puts a lot of blisters on your hands. But I still use this for things like headstocks and detail work. For cutting out body blanks nowadays, I use a bow saw. And a bow saw is great. You simply tighten it up by tightening the string. This pulls on the arms and increases tension on the blade. And I can cut out, for example, a Telecaster or Les Paul style body with a bow saw from a solid blank in 15 minutes or so with this. It's a really, really good saw. Then you're going to want saws for doing long straight cuts and all sorts of other things. And for that I use primarily Japanese saws. The Ryoba is great. It's got two types of teeth for different types of grain. I also use this small flexible Japanese saw and this Japanese saw which has a rigid spine on the back. Now I use Japanese saws because, well, I live in Japan and they're what you get at the hardware store, but also they're pull saws and they give a very, very nice cut. When I use this saw as well, I use it for the third type of cutting, which is the fret slots. And when I do fret slots, I have a miter box. Miter box is really important because it means that when you're cutting the frets, you're cutting at 90 degrees. You see, if your saw comes down at an angle rather than straight down, then if you sand away some of the fingerboard, gradually your fret's going to move and it's going to affect your intonation. A miter box is actually a really good investment. It also makes your cuts a lot more accurate and the whole process easier. Okay, let's go on and have a look at the hand planes. Now, I've actually got way too many hand planes. You don't need this many, I just really love them. I'm going to start by looking at the bench planes, and I've got Stanleys made in England. These are actually old planes that I bought and restored. So when I got them, they were rusty, and I put new blades and chip breakers in them. I refinished the handles and stuff like that. So they're really good. And now, the different sizes have different functions. The number 6 can be used as what's called a four-plane or a jointer. You use this for very, very long things. For example, flattening the top of neck blanks would be something. You can use it on bodies when you want to get a long section flat, and it's really a very, very good plane. The second one is the jack plane. This is literally the jack of all trades. You use this for flattening, you can use it for the same sorts of jobs as the number six, but if you dial it back a bit, you can also smooth with it and get some very fine cuts. It's good for flattening large surfaces, it's also good for making a nice, smooth, clean surface. The number 4 is a smooth plane. It's not that good for long surfaces. It'll do it, but it's not as efficient as the others. This, however, will create a glass-like surface, especially as long as you keep the blade really, really sharp. Other planes I use for similar things. I use this plane, which is a Japanese plane, a kana, which has a wooden block and a blade here, and use a hammer. And what you do is you tap the blade in, or you tap the back of the block to move the blade out. And it's a really, really fun plane, and again, it creates an extremely smooth surface. The difference is, Western planes you push, Japanese planes you pull. Other useful planes in the same kind of category are block planes. Everyone should have block planes. These are so useful. This is a standard Stanley block plane, and I use this for headstocks, I use this for tenons, I use this for just about every part of the build. Even when I'm smoothing the sides, I'll use this to take things down. It's a really, really useful plane, and I wouldn't be without it. Another block plane that I have is this, which is a rabbiting block plane. The difference is that on a regular block plane, the blade stops before the edge. On this one, it goes all the way across, and it allows me to get right into tenons and things like that and get really good smooth surfaces. This is a superb plane. It's made by Lee Nielsen, and it's a really wonderful thing. This was a gift from a very good friend. The same friend gave me another pair of planes, which I use often, and it's the number 98 and 99 planes. And if you've got a long straight channel, for example a truss rod channel, you can put these planes in there, adjust the blade, push them along, and it'll smooth up the sides of the channel. These are really great little planes. There's a left-handed and a right-handed version, so you can go all the way along on both sides of the channel. And this fence here is actually removable so that you can go right up to the tip of the blade. Other Japanese planes, I've got this rather tiny little cute plane. It's more of a toy than anything else, but sometimes I use it if I'm doing some detailed work. And I've got a Japanese rabbiting plane. It does roughly the same sort of job as this, but it's thin and it gets into small spaces. It's light, it's easy to use, and this cost me virtually nothing. Now, for carving tops, things like Les Paul tops and getting those sexy contours, I use, you know, gouges and things like that, which I'll talk about in a second, but I also use violin makers' planes. Another really good friend sent me this plane as a present. It's an Ibex plane. It's got a curved base. And so if you're carving a top, you can get in there with this and it'll take up curved little curls of wood. It's a really good little plane. And I use it with a normal blade. He also very kindly sent me a toothed blade, which does a really, really great job. It's a fabulous blade. I do recommend toothed blades as something to explore if you're into planes. If I'm doing smaller detailed work, I use this little tiny palm plane. I use this in complex curves. Sometimes I use it on the sides of bodies or around headstocks to get details right. It's a really nice little plane made by Veritas. Now, for cavities, getting the bottom of the cavity right, for large cavities, pickup cavities, mortise tenon joints, that sort of thing, a router plane. If you don't have an actual mechanical powered router, then a router plane will do the job for you. And what a router plane is, as you can see, basically a blade and handles. So you put it into your cavity, and you push it along, and it takes up a curl of wood. And then you just take it down a little, push it along again. One trick that I would mention with router planes is that sometimes the blade doesn't go as deeply as you want it for things like pickup cavities. So what you do in that case is you simply detach the blade from the depth screw. Come on. And then you use the collar to let the blade move down freely. And you can get down much, much further with the router plane. So I have this router plane. I also have this little mini router plane that I picked up. And it's cute. Again, it's a bit like this plane. It's more of a toy than anything else. But I have used it on inlays and things, and it does do the bottom of inlay cavities quite nicely. Okay, let's go on and have a look at some chisels now. I've got a pretty broad selection and you probably don't need this many of them. When I started out building, for the first couple of guitars I made, all I had was a kind of cheap set of chisels from the hardware store and a gouge. And the cheap chisels were fine. The thing about cheaper chisels is that the steel is not so good. So what will happen is that it'll take an edge very, very quickly. You can sharpen it and get them really, really sharp, but they won't stay sharp very long. So better chisels have better steel. It'll hold a nice sharp edge and it'll stay sharp for a really long time. So don't worry too much about chisel price. You know, you can buy cheap ones, just be prepared to sharpen them a lot. The primary bench chisels I use are this set here by Ashley Illers. They're bench chisels. They're very thin here. They've got a beautiful profile, and I've got them from this relatively broad size right down to, this is about 3 mil, and I really can get into tiny spaces with this, nut slots and things. It's a fabulous chisel. And I use this set all the time. I primarily keep them very sharp, and I'll use them, you know, as paring chisels, always working away from my hands, of course. But occasionally, and they've got sturdy Bubinga handles, I will use a mallet on them if I'm doing particular work. I won't really hammer into them, but I'll use a mallet to kind of drive them along in certain cases. Other chisels that I use which are similar are Japanese chisels. These are really, really good. They've got folded steel. They take a really, really sharp edge. I find these a little bit brutal, actually, compared to the Ashley Illers chisels. And that's odd, because a lot of people talk about the subtlety of Japanese chisels. And I've used a lot, and they're pretty good, but for guitar building, I find the Western chisels to be just that little bit more useful. Still, I've got a nice, wide, broad chisel here, which I can use to get straight lines. I use this for the side of pickup cavities, you know, mortise and tenon joints, all that sort of stuff. Really good. And again, similar sizes down to a relatively narrow chisel. And I keep the backs of these more or less flat. They're slightly hollow ground for ease of sharpening, but you can really get into spaces and work with these very well. They're very good paring chisels, and they've got an iron ring here, so they actually take a hammer quite happily. I use a lot of small chisels, you know, wood carving things, including a very narrow one here, which I use for the corners of inlays. Primarily those are inlaying chisels. I don't use them so much in the rest of the building. And I use gouges a lot. There are two types of gouges. There are gouges which have the edge here on the outside and the inside is smooth. And then there are gouges which have the outside smooth and the inside with the edge ground into it. These ones are, well, by me, they're used primarily for the inside of pickup cavities and things to get a smooth curve. I don't really use them for much else. I don't use them for a lot of carving otherwise. But these gouges, which have the edge on the outside and the smooth part on the inside, I use for top carving. I use around the headstock, I use again around the body and all sorts of places. I often undercarve the tops of my guitars, and so I get in there with a gouge. This is a number 6 gouge, and I've used this one for ages. This is the first gouge I bought. It's really good steel. And again, I have an Ashley Illers number 6 sweep gouge, slightly longer and easier to work with. It's the same pattern as the bench chisels, and it's a really nice tool. With all of these, the real key is to keep them sharp. And I'm going to be talking about that next. On to sharpening. And sharpening is really, really important, of course. You can have a $500 hand plane, but if the blade isn't sharp, it's a doorstop. So sharpening well, sharpening frequently, these are keys to good hand tool usage with planes, with chisels and things. Also, blunt tools are dangerous. If you're using a blunt chisel and you're kind of pushing it along and forcing it along, it won't move, and then suddenly it'll move and, you know, that's the way you can slice off fingers. So you have to be really, really careful. sharper tools, and I know it sounds counterintuitive, are basically safer tools. Now, when I sharpen, I tend to use water stones. I use them purely because, again, they're what's available in the hardware stores here in Japan. For example, this is a combination 1,000 and 3,000 grit stone. I've got a 6,000 stone here that I will sometimes finish on. I've even got a 12,000 grit stone that I use sometimes if I want to get a really, really kind of nice mirror finish. And these are used for chisels and plane blades. For the higher grit stones, I use something called a nagara stone, which again you get wet and you rub on and it creates a slurry, and that slurry helps cut. So this is a very useful thing if you're using finer water stones. The other water stones I use, I've got these shaped water stones which are used for sharpening gouges. And this will sharpen the outside curve of the gouge. And then there are slip stones like this with curves here and here, which can sharpen the inside of the gouge. There are also slip stones like this with grooves kind of ground into a water stone. You can also use sandpaper on dowel and all sorts of other things, and you can use sandpaper on glass for plane blades if you want to, but I happen to like water stones. The biggest thing about water stones is to keep them flat. There's a great temptation to use your water stone and then just leave it, but what that'll do is put a grooved surface in, and the next time you sharpen a plane on it, you'll be sharpening unevenly and it won't do you any good. So in order to keep the stones flat, I actually use this, which is a hard stone, and I use some graphite powder and a bit of water, and I flatten out my stones between every usage. Then I clean them well to make sure there's none of the graphite powder remaining, otherwise that will do the sharpening instead of the stone and you'll get too rough a finish. Now, you can sharpen by hand. I respect people who do that tremendously, but I have never really been able to get consistent enough results, you know, blades that I can just shave with, sharpening by hand. So I've used a selection of jigs. When I started out, I used this standard Eclipse jig. Goes on the stone, you put your tool in, and away you go. It's great, but it's a little bit hard to set the angle, and I find it tends to rock a bit. Still, these are cheap and readily available. Nowadays, however, I use the Veritas Mark II honing jig, which is a really good thing. You've got this guide on here, which allows you to set the angle. Then you put your blade in through the underneath, hits the stop here at the correct angle. You tighten up this, and then you simply remove the guide, put it on the stone, and along you go. It's very easy to use. It's got a nice wide roller so it doesn't rock from side to side. If you do want to rock from side to side, say if you want to round off the edges of a plane blade slightly and do something called a camber, then it comes with a camber roller attachment, or you can buy a camber roller attachment, which is flat in the middle and then kind of tapers up here so you can rock back and forth just on the edges of your plane blade. Now I'll go right up in grits. When I finish, sometimes I'll use, for example, a leather strop, and I'll charge it with metal polish, and I can get a really, really nice mirror shine. As I said, I tend to sharpen frequently, and I tend to make sure that my stones are always flat, because sharp tools work well. If your tools are blunt, the blades will pitch, you'll just do them damage over time. So sharpen frequently, sharpen carefully and accurately. On to drills now, and there's not a lot to say really. The primary drill I use is this, which is an egg beater drill. You've just got a handle that you turn and you drill away. It's a very useful, very simple design. You can find these used, you can find them new. They're not expensive. I will sometimes combine this with a drill stand so that I put it on, I turn it, and then it turns a drill here. This allows me to drill down very accurately. It's important to clamp it. And I can also change the angle here, so I can drill at quite acute angles and do things like the truss rod plug on Telecaster headstocks, all that sort of stuff. That helps a lot. I'll also use this hand-driven one. And this uses drills primarily, which have little cutting edges here and often a screw to get them properly into the wood. Another thing that I use a lot is a bit with a brace. I use Forstner bits and a brace. This is really old school, kind of manly stuff. And the good thing about Forstner bits is because they're at 90 degree walls to the cutting surface, they tend to be self-guiding. You can do quite long cuts. And I use these for things like control cavities, pickup cavities. They cut a large flat bottomed hole with only a tiny little dent in it. So you can clear up most of the wood, and then you can go in and clean up with chisels and a router plane, for example. And it's important to have a wide variety of Forstner bit sizes. There are all sorts of drills in different sizes. You can get these easily, countersink bits, things like that. And something else I use is a reamer. And I'll use that when I'm doing tuners. A reamer is very useful just for getting holes to the right size. A final tip is that if you're doing things like the dots on the side of a neck, and let's say your neck is already installed and you don't want to go in there with a drill and damage your finish, smaller drills, 2 to 3 millimeters, you can wrap a bit of tape around them, put them in there, and just use your fingers. A little bit of finger pressure, and you can drill a very accurate hole. Okay, let's go on and have a look at some files and rasps. And these are very important. They clean up your rough edges. They smooth things out after you've been at it with a bow saw or a Japanese saw. And they're very, very useful. And probably the one I use the most is this one. It's a Shinto rasp, it's called. It's a saw rasp. This side is smooth and this side is quite rough. And I use this for smoothing the sides of bodies. I use it for carving necks. I use it for just about anything you can imagine. It's a really great rasp. I recommend this. A rasp that is also superb, and I use a lot as well, is the microplane. And these are actually sold by kitchen supply shops, amongst other places. This is a flat microplane, and again, you can use it on necks. It works very quickly and works very well. And this is what's left of a round microplane, which is really essential for getting into the backs of headstocks and getting into difficult curves, which you'll encounter in your guitar building. I like the microplanes a lot. My only argument is that they do tend to blunten fairly quickly, whereas the Shinto rasp is just as good as it was the day I got it, you know, a couple of years ago. I also have more standard rasps, and they generally come with smooth sides and coarser sides. They may have a safe edge, which is an edge with nothing on it, or they may have a file edge. Round rasps, again, of various descriptions. I don't have any really fancy, expensive rasps. Perhaps one day I'll go out and buy them. I've got a large variety of these small files, which, you know, you can buy in cheap sets from hardware stores. I use, again, small needle files coated with diamond in order to do things like cleaning up fret slots and cleaning up fret ends and nut slots and all that stuff. This is a fret file, specifically a fret file, which has a safe edge here, and you can use this for cleaning the edges of the frets to get that smooth feel as you move your hand along them. For the frets themselves, I like to use this. This is a diamond file. It's got a curve here, a curve here. This side is medium. This side is large. And it does a very nice job on cleaning up your frets when you've just done a fret level. And it makes them nice and round again. And of course, because it's got these angles, you can get in and work, or you can just work on the flat. Good tool. This is the regular file version. It's fine, but it doesn't stay sharp too long. The diamond version cuts much faster, is much better. This file here is used for the end of the frets. When the frets are all installed, you put this on the neck and you run it along, and this is set at an angle, and it does a really, really good job of just angling the frets. Personally, I find the angle a little too acute, so I tend to put something underneath it here, get a slightly less acute angle, but that's just me. Finally, a very useful set of files, and a lot of guitar builders don't bother to get these, and they always have trouble as a result. These are nut files, nut slot files, and I paid perhaps $100 for this set, but it's paid for itself many times over. Anytime you do a setup on a guitar, whether it's yours or one for a friend, these are fantastic. They go from 10 right through to 50, this set, it's 8 files. And they are curved on the bottom, and there's nothing on the sides, and you can do really, really good nut slots with these. Now here I'm going to look at the tools that don't fit into the categories I gave before. First of all, safety glasses. Anytime you're going to do anything where sharp pieces of metal might fly around or anything dangerous could happen, get some safety glasses. They're cheap and they'll save you, they'll save your eyes, very important. I use various types of pliers. I use long nose, I use regular pliers. I use all sorts of different cutters for wires, for fret pulling. And for the ends of frets, I have a set of flat ground cutters. And these are really important for getting a nice flush cut up against the end of the fingerboard. I use a really interesting tool called a grommel. And the grommel is great. It's got a blade down here and you can adjust the distance of the blade, you can turn it back and forth, it's got a curved side and a flat side, and you can use this for marking lines when you're doing cutting. You can also use it for cutting binding. If you go in very carefully, you can cut a whole binding channel with this. The grommel is a really good tool. I use a lot of scrapers. These are called Carruth scrapers. I got them from Stuart MacDonald, a guitar supply shop. And they've got a curved side, they're great for curved tops, they've got a flat side. You can use these on fingerboards, you can use these on sides of guitars, anywhere you like. I've got different sizes, different types of scrapers with different curves. This is called a French curve. This scraper is quite useful. There's a flat scraper for, you know, headstock faces and things. I also often simply use razor blades. Razor blades are really good too. Buy a pack of cheap razor blades and you can get a really good scrape. One thing I do recommend is just file the corners a little bit, otherwise you get little deep gouges. I've got a wide variety of knives. I particularly like this Japanese knife for neck carving. It does a really good job on certain parts of that job and I keep it nice and sharp. And, you know, any kind of disposable knife, you're just going to find yourself reaching for one of these all the time. Speaking of awls, I use an awl for placing dots if I'm doing inlays, and that starts off drilling holes, side dots, all that sort of stuff. Awls are they're really handy tools to have. You'll find yourself using a variety of Allen keys when you're dealing with hardware. My advice is buy yourself a set of metric Allen keys and buy yourself a set of inch Allen keys. You're going to need both depending on the hardware you're using. When you're measuring, there are lots of important measuring tools. Calipers sometimes come in handy if you want to check the thickness of an undercarved top. You're going to need rulers. Good quality steel rules are really important. A really short one you're going to use a lot. A really long one you're going to use a lot. And a set like this also is very, very important. Extremely useful. You'll find yourself using a wide variety of wrenches and screwdrivers, flathead and Phillips. You'll find yourself using spanners of various sizes. This is a nice small one. And you'll find yourself using a lot of clamps when you're gluing. It's important to have a wide variety of clamps of different types and depths. These clamps are actually used more than you'd think when you're doing a body. And longer clamps are used quite frequently as well. I use different hammers. Particularly, I use this hammer for fretting. I've also got a wooden mallet that I'll sometimes use for driving chisels, but as I mentioned before, I try not to thump away my chisels too much. When it comes to fretting, there are a bunch of other specialist tools. I like this. It's a fret wire bender, and it gives a consistent radius. You don't need this, you can do it by hand, but I find this helps a lot. When I'm putting frets into the board, I use this call. It's got a curved piece of brass here. It's got a magnet on the back. I put it in the vise, tighten up the handle, and it pushes the fret into the slot. I can change the calls to different radii. This is 16, this is 12. The ends of the frets, I can use a fret end nibbler here, which will just cut off a little bit of the tang. So if you've got a bound fingerboard, you can put the fret straight in. I mentioned the vise before. A good bench vise is very important. Also here, I've got a little tiny vise that I bought from a local shop. And this vise I use when I'm making nuts. I put the little vise in the small nut, in the big vise, and it allows me to do quite accurate work. What else do we have here? Ah, yes, sanding. Sanding's really important. Any type of sanding beam is really great. I use stick-on sandpaper and get a nice flat line. When I'm radiusing a board, putting the curve on the board, you use a radius block. You stick on sandpaper in different grades. And I've got one in 12-inch radius, long sanding block, and I use this all the time. 12 is my most common radius, which is why I bought this. And it's a very, very useful, efficient thing. A long sanding block is great. The shorter the sanding block, the less accurate you're likely to be. So a nice long sanding block is really good. I use all sorts of sanding devices. I will use, things with handles. I'll use leftover bits of wood, wrap paper around them. I've used sanding sponges. They're very nice. And anytime I need to sand a curve, I just get something round, put sandpaper around it, and off I go. Whether it's a pencil or a bottle of lemon oil or whatever I need to match the diameter of the curve. I've also used a lot a system called the Katana fret leveling system, and there's actually another video on how to use that on my channel, and I do recommend that to you. So go and look at that if you want to look at a specific fret leveling tool. But these are basically kind of the standard tools that don't fit into any of the categories I've mentioned so far. So let's finish this video up by talking quickly about the sorts of tools you might want to have if you're going to start out. I've got a lot of tools I've been building for about 4 years, and I've collected a whole bunch that make my life easier, but strictly speaking, I don't always need. What would you need if you're just starting out? If you're making an electric guitar of the simplest type, like a Telecaster, I would say that you would need a basic chisel set, a jack plane, a block plane, either a bow saw or a coping saw, some type of ryoba or long cutting saw, wood saw, a saw for cutting fret slots, a rasp of some type, an egg beater drill and different bits for it, a bit and brace with Forstner bits, a sharpening jig to keep your tools sharp. You'll need clamps and files. You'll need a sanding block for the radius. You'll need various measuring tools and a screwdriver set. If you've got that, you should be able to get into things. If you want to get more sophisticated, then perhaps the next tool to add would be a router plane. If you're doing a curved top, then you're going to need a couple of extra tools. At the minimum, you'll need a gouge, and I'd recommend some good scrapers and maybe violin makers' planes if you want to go down that path. But really, I once knew a guy who makes viola da gamba. He makes really wonderful instruments, and I asked him what his minimum tools would be. And he said, oh, you know, you can make an instrument with a knife. And he thought about it for a while, and then he said, maybe two knives.